session will start with Masahide Yamaguchi, who was initially the last speaker. So Masahide, the floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you for the introduction and hello everyone. And first of all, I'd like to thank the organizer for invitation. Today, I'm going to talk about cosmological perturbation in Palatine formalism. And this work is in collaboration with Mio Kubota and Kin Yaoda and Keigo Shimada. Okay. And the content of my talk is as follows. First of all, I'm not sure how many people are familiar with the Palatine formalism. So first, I'm going to make some brief introduction to the Palatine formalism. And I'm going to extend general relativity to more generic scalar tensor theory in the Palatine formalism. And I would discuss the cosmological perturbation based on such an extension. And finally, I summarize my talk. And in fact, Palatine formalism has a long, long history, and there are many, many references related to Palatine formalism. So I omit most of them in this talk. So I'm so sorry if I miss some important reference. Okay. And as you know, inflation and dark energy, that is cosmic acceleration in the early universe and the current universe, are strongly supported by observations like cosmic microwave background anisotropy or supernovae or BAO or something else. And the next question is in order to identify, you see, the inflaton and the source of dark energy, it's quite useful to consider the most general models as wide as possible based on the scalar tensor theory. And once we have such a general models, we can constrain models or single out the true model finally from the observational result. This approach is so-called a bottom-up approach. Then the question is following. What is the most general scalar tensor theory, okay, to accommodate the inflation or dark energy? So you may wonder how widely can we extend scalar tensor theory? And for example, let me begin with the minimal or basic scalar tensor theory with the Einstein-Hilbert action plus a canonical kinetic term of the scalar field. Then, of course, we can introduce a non-minimal coupling like F phi R, originally Brandt-Dicke proposed. And this type of coupling has received renewed interest recently in the context of the Higgs inflation. And also, scalar fields, kinetic term of scalar field is not necessarily canonical. We can take a more generic action consisting of the generic function of phi and x, like a k inflation and k ss. And furthermore, if we can introduce a higher derivative term, like a box phi or even a higher derivative. But as you know, generally speaking, if action includes a higher derivative terms, it leads to the some Gauss-Key degree of freedom and the dangerous. Shown by the Ostrogradsky more than 150 years ago. And this kind of feature can be easily understood. For example, if the action includes a second derivative and go into the field theory, equation motion becomes a fourth order differential equation, like this one. And if we estimate the propagator to check the dynamical degree of freedom, this propagator can be decomposed into the two parts, two poles. And one of them has a long time of the kinetic term, which is nothing but the Gauss degree of freedom. Okay. So generally speaking, if we consider the higher derivative term, it's dangerous. So the question is that how to obtain a higher derivative theory without Gauss degree of freedom? And generally speaking, there are two methods. First one is two abundant non-degeneracy conditions, which is assumed in the Ostrogradsky theorem. So we have only to consider the degeneracy theory, like a Dost theory. Another is to go into the infinite derivative theories, like a non-local gravity or something like that. But in this talk, we confine ourselves to the first option. And the one of the famous such a degenerate example is the so-called Galilean theory. If the Galilean theory has a Galilean shift symmetry in flat space or Minkowski background, like this one, like this one, then allowed term is a list of the allowed term is like this one. And this action apparently includes the higher derivative terms, but the equation motion stays up to the second order. This case, strictly equation motion becomes the second order. Then it's completely safe and can avoid the Gauss degree of freedom. Then the question is that this theory is based on the flat theory, flat Minkowski background. So how to covariantize? This is the question. And if we treat gravity, at least there are two formulas. First one is a very famous metric formalism, and the other is a paradigmic formalism. Of course, we have another formalism, but here we are going to concentrate on the paradigmic formalism. So just to compare the metric formalism and the paradigmic formalism. And let me begin with a brief review of the metric formalism and the paradigmic formalism by emphasizing their difference. And the fundamental object or independent variable in metric formalism is just a Riemann metric, which is a symmetric second rank tensor determining the length. And in case of the metric formalism, connection is fixed a priori to be the Levi-Civita connection. And Levi-Civita is, of course, a symmetric feature, and Levi-Civita is a symmetric, and also it satisfies the metric compatibility. And this kind of requirement comes from the presence of the local Lorentz frame and also the invariance of angle between parallel transported vectors. Okay. So in case of the metric formalism, independent variable is just a Riemann metric. So we have only to take a variation of action with respect to only a metric in order to obtain the equation motion. On the other hand, in paratin formalism, fundamental object, or I should say, independent variables are not only Riemann metrics, but also the connection. Connection is not fixed to be the Levi-Civita a priori. This is also independent variable, and its form is determined by the equation motion. And in this case, connection is not necessarily torsion free, and also connection does not satisfy metricity in general. And in general, torsion does not vanish, but for simplicity, in my talk, we consider only a torsionless case and introduce the non-metricity only. And anyway, in this case, for paratini formalism, variation of action with respect to not only metric, but also the connection need to be taken in order to obtain the equation motion. This is a crucial difference between metric formalism and paratini formalism. And to be honest, I'm not so sure which formalism is natural or good or better. Probably observation will determine it. But normally, in the sense of the gauge theory, for example, we know that some gauge theory like electromagnetic dynamics, and this is an action for electrodynamic U1 based on the U1 gauge symmetry, you see. And at least in this internal gauge symmetry, we take a variation of action with respect to not only electric field or Dirac field itself, but also the connection or gauge field. So in the context of the gauge field, you see, gauge theories, paratini formalism might be more natural, but there is a crucial difference between paratini formalism or this standard, for example, U1 gauge theory, because this case gauge field is completely dynamical, but in paratini formalism, it's not necessarily dynamical, and actually it can be the constraint. So there is still some subtlety and difference. Anyway, in my talk, we take a paratini formalism. And before going to the generic scalar tensor theory in paratini formalism, let me briefly review the Einstein gravity in paratini formalism. So this is an action of the Einstein gravity, just simply the Einstein-Hilbert action. But this Ricci scalar is determined by generic connection, not necessary to be Lebesgue, not necessary Lebesgue beta, and also introduce a matter function, and assume the no dependence on connection for simplicity. And in this case, we need to take the variation of action with respect to not only metrics, but also the connection. Okay. And variation of action with respect to metric is just given the equation motion for gravity. And variation of action with respect to connection gives the constraint for the connection itself. And from this equation, we can easily show that in case of the Einstein gravity, even in Paratini formalism, metricity holds true. Then, by assuming the torsionless conditions, in this case, particular case, even in Paratini formalism, connection is coincide with the Lebesgue beta as a result of equation motion. Okay, so as long as we confine ourselves to the Einstein gravity, essentially there is no difference between metric formalism and the Paratini formalism. Because even if we consider the Paratini formalism, as a result of the equation motion, connection is shown to be Lebesgue beta. So there is essentially no difference. Then let's try to extend this Einstein gravity to more generic scalar tensor theory in Paratini formalism. But before going to Paratini formalism, let's briefly remember scalar tensor theory in metric formalism. Okay. And what we would like to do is to extend this flat Galilean or Galilean theory in flat space to more gravity case. So how to covariantize this flat Galilean action in metric formalism? This is the question. And this question was addressed by many people. And actually, these people proposed a so-called generalized Galilean theory, which can be characterized by four generic functions. And actually, this action includes many famous models as a subset of this action. This is nothing but the K-inflation K-sense model. This is Galilean actions. And this is a non-minimal coupling to gravity. And if we consider the G5, it also includes the so-called new Higgs inflation models. So actually, these models include many famous models of some things. But this model has not been most general scalar tensor theory whose equation motion is the second order. And actually, now it's getting famous and famous. 1974, Horodesky has already presented the most general action. Okay. So you may wonder what is the relationship between the recently proposed general Galilean and the Horodesky theory. Then Kobayashi and Yokoyama and myself prove that both models are completely equivalent through this correspondence. Then now, Horodesky is known to be the most general, and thanks to our proof of the equivalence between general Galilean and Horodesky, then general Galilean is also shown to be the most general. Okay. So you may wonder, how about a cosmological perturbation in the general Galilean? And in the same paper, we gave the generic formula of the tensor perturbation and the scalar perturbation. And the interesting point is that the sound speed of the tensor perturbation is given by the ratio of these two quantities. And you can easily find that if G45 x dependence, this is G45 x represents the derivative of G5 with respect to x. So if G4 has an x dependence, or if we have a non-constant G5, tensor sound velocity can easily deviate from unity. And on the other hand, recent simultaneous observation of the gravitational wave and the gamma ray burst suggests that the speed of the counter speed of the gravitational wave must be very close to unity. So if this Horn-Jesky field is responsible for dark energies, sound velocity must be very close to unity, then this X dependence on of G4 and G5 dependence must be ruled out from the observation. And this kind of argument is one of the good merit for to consider the most general model or bottom-up approach. Okay. And now let's move on to the parrot uniformism. And shall we extend the flat Galilean action in the parrot uniformism? And what we'd like to do is to find the Horn-Jesky correspondence in parrot uniformism. And unfortunately, we have not yet found a complete correspondence in parrot uniformism. So just partially we are going to address in this talk. And let me begin with the non-minimal coupling of scalar field to Ricci scalar. Okay. And which is given in case of the metric homomorphism, those are given by the this L2 term and L4 term. And we will discuss L2 term later, L3 term, or Galilean term later. And in case of metric homomorphism, important point is that if G4 has X dependence, we need this extra term to keep the equation motion second order. Okay. This counter term is necessary. On the other hand, in case of the parrot uniformism, even if G4 has this X dependence, in order to keep the second order of the equation motion, we don't need this kind of this counter term. We can easily show that, confirm that. Okay. So, first, let me discuss this action in the parrot uniformism. And the central question is that, you see, in case of the metric formalism, if G4 has X dependence, then tensor sound velocity deviates from unity. So what happens in parrot uniformism? This feature is still robustism or not? Okay, this is a central question. And in order to address these questions, we make analysis in three different frames. First one is a so-called Jordan frame. We discuss this action as it is. Okay, so we keep just this non-minimal couplings. And the calculation is tedious, but in some sense, very straightforward. Just treat this action as it is. And another method is so-called, another frame is so-called Jordan frame. We try to make a conformal transformation and to kill the to remove this non-minimal coupling. So once we make a conformal transformation, we obtain the Einstein gravity with some k-sense actions, even in this parrot uniformism. Then calculation is very well known because in Einstein gravity there is essentially no difference between parrot uniformism and metric formalism. So we can just borrow the result of the from the result from the calculation in the metric formalism. And in fact, this calculation is commonly used in the literature, especially in the context of the Higgs simulations. Most of work is used just this Einstein frame. And yet another frame is we call the Riemann frame, you see, because as we've shown that, as we will show, connection is not necessary, does not necessarily coincide with the Levi-Civita in parrot uniformism. In fact, connection is a Levi-Civita plus some extra contribution in general. So once we know that this form and insert this action, so we can rewrite this action in terms of the Levi-Civita. Okay. So in this sense, we can always find those actions in parrot uniformism equivalent, and which is equivalent to some action in metric formalism, if we can find this form. And we call this frame the Riemann frame. Actually, this is just every calculation can be done in the metric formulas. Just we rewrite this connection in terms of the Levi-Civita plus some extra correction. Okay. Anyway, yeah, we're going to show the quadratic action in three different ways. And first, let me begin with the Jordan frame. And this is just the original actions. And we have only to take the action, a variation of action with respect to metric and the connection. Okay. And this just gives the gravitational equation motion. And this determines the form of the connection. And actually, in this case, we can easily solve this equation. And in fact, once G4 is not constant, metricity is broken. And through this equation, we can easily find the actual concrete form of the connection. And in fact, this action is written the combination of the Levi-Civita part plus some corrections, which depends on form of G4. Okay. And of course, if G4 is constant, this term vanish, which is nothing but the Einstein gravity then. Even in Palatine formalism, connection is shown to coincide with Levi-Civita. Okay. But in general, it does not coincide with Levi-Civita. And let's move on to the cosmological perturbations. And in Palatine formalism, we should perturb not only metric, but also connection, like this way. And it's a bit complicated, but the calculation is a straightforward. And we have only to estimate the quadratic action by inserting these perturbations. So expand the action up to quadratic over of the perturbation of metric and connections, and solve the constraint for lapse and shift, and in this case, connection as well, because connections are not dynamical, okay, just a constraint. And once we solve such a constraint, we can easily obtain the quadratic action for the tensor perturbation and also the quadratic action for the scalar perturbation. And even if G4 has X dependence, interestingly, sound speed of the tensor perturbation is still shown to be unity. Okay. So this is sharp contrast with the case of the metric formalism. Now let's move on to the calculation in Einstein frame. So what we have to do is to make a conformal transformation. Okay. And in general, in case of the metric formalism, if we make a conformal transformation, the transformation of the each scalar is a bit complicated. But in case of the Palatine formalism, metric and curvature are completely independent. So the form of the rich scalar is quite simple. See? Even if we make a conformal transformation. And actually, after the conformal transformation, this action is shown to be this type of the Einstein gravity with some K-sense action. Okay. And once we obtain this form, as I have already shown, in case of the Einstein gravity, connection coincide with the Levi-Civita. So we can use the result of the metric formalism. And this is nothing but Einstein gravity, Einstein-Hilbert action plus K-sense term. So as you know that the tensor perturbation in such Einstein gravity is given by this one, and tensor sound speed is of course unity. Okay. So finally, let's move on to the Riemann frame. Okay. So starting from this Jordan actions, we obtain the generic form of the curvature as a result of the equation motion. Okay. So once we have this form, concrete form of connections, we can insert this relationship to this rich scalar. And actually, this rich scalar with respect to gamma becomes a combination of the rich scalar with respect to Levi-Civita plus some connection, some collections. And this covariant derivative is also can be taken with respect to Levi-Civita. So all of quantities can be rewritten in terms of the Levi-Civita connection. Then we call this frame is a Riemann frame. And in fact, this Jordan frame action can be rewritten as some quantities in terms of the Levi-Civita action. Okay. And very interestingly, you see, this action reduced to the so-called dosed action in metric formulation. So we can borrow the result of the in the metric formulation. And in fact, quadratic action for perturbation are shown to coincide with those in the Einstein frame and those in the dosed action, dosed calculations. Okay. So let me briefly summarize up to here. So we consider this action in the Paratini formalism and discuss the cosmological perturbation in three frames. And the quadratic action for tensor perturbation and the scalar perturbation, three different frames are obtained are shown to be the same. And even if G4 has X dependence, speed of gravitational wave is unity, which is completely different from the case of the metric formalism. And finally, let me briefly discuss the Galilean action in Paratini formalism, this box file, for the remaining time. And let me begin with the Galilean action in metric formalism. And the first important point is that this box phi term is uniquely determined in the metric formalism. Of course, we can insert some arbitrary part. We can insert g mu nu in the arbitrary part. But thanks to the metricity, okay, all of g's expression is completely same and equivalent in metric formalism. This is the first important point. And another important point is that this box phi term does not affect the speed of gravitational wave in the metric format, because this kind of G3 term never appears in the quadratic action for the tensor perturbation. So even if we have a G3 terms, it does not affect the tensor sound velocity. Okay. On the other hand, in Paratini formalism, it's quite non-trivial. First, even if we consider this is a schematical figure, you see, box phi, it's not uniquely determined in Paratini formalism because we don't have metricities. So depending on where we insert g mu nu, you see, g is three times completely gives a different term. Okay. And also the way of the contraction of the G mu nu, you see, this kind of the contraction and the position way of the this contraction. Depending on such a way, we can construct many different terms, even if we just consider the scalar part of the two derivatives. But very fortunately, we can show that there are only 10 numbers of the equivalent terms. And where we insert a derivative and how to contract the matrix, depending on such features, we can have a 10 equivalent terms. And if we consider the all of these 10 equivalent terms with the k-essence term and the non-minimal couplings, this action has a, in general, no Einstein frame, Ostrogonsky ghost mode, and sound velocity can deviate from unity in general. Okay. But very interestingly, if we remove this ghost degree of freedom by taking the suitable choice of the this combination, okay, this model reduced to the dosed models in metric formalism with sound speed of the gravitational wave being unity. Okay. So this is quite an interesting future. So let me summarize my talk. We consider the Paratini formalism in which the variation of the action must be taken with respect to not only metric, but also to connections. And we consider the case of the nominal coupling of scalar field to risk scalar plus case actions and discuss the cosmological perturbation. And we consider the three different frames and of course, all of the quadratic actions shown to be same. And the sound speed of the gravitational wave is always unity, even if G45x dependent in case of the Paratini formalism. This is completely different from that in the metric formalism. And we also classify the Darylian action in Paratini formalism and found that there are essentially 10 different terms. And in general, if we consider the all of these 10 terms, this action leads to the Gorsky degree of freedom and the sound velocity can deviate from unities. But once we eliminate such a Gauss degree of freedom, sound speed of the tensor perturbation reduce unity, which is coincide with the metric formalism. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Masaide, for this very clear talk. So do we have questions? Yes.
Yeah, so thank you very much for the talk. I had just a naive question. I cannot understand how the action can be reduced to those. It's like going to Palatini formalism is like doing a disformal transformation or what? So what is the relation between writing Hausdorffsky in Palatini formalism and getting dosed?
Ah, okay. So I just saying that this case, maybe this one, you see. Just I said, let's begin with this action in Palatini formalism. Okay. And we obtain the this form of connection in Palatini formalism. In case of the metric formalism, a priori gamma is taken to be Lebesgue. But in case of the Paratini formalism, starting from this action, a connection is shown to be the Lebesgue plus some correction. Okay? And if we rewrite this action, just inserting this gamma into this part, okay, and this case, rich scalar with respect to this gamma is shown to be the rich scalar with respect to Lebesgue plus connection. Okay. And once we insert this relationship to this original actions, then it is equivalent to the dosed in metric formalism, or I should say, in Lebesgue connection.
Okay, that's very clear. But I wanted to understand, is there an intuition why we get dosed from this? This is what
I'm not sure it depends on the definition of dosed. Just to say, we don't have a 2 plus 1 degree of freedom, and this theory is included even higher derivative term. It's degenerate, you see.
Okay.
This is, in some sense, definition of the dosed. So,
yeah.
Okay, yeah. So just no Gorsky degree of freedom and just 2 plus 1. So in some sense, it's quite straightforward to reduce dose if we rewrite this action in terms of the metric, Lebesgue.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Evgeny?
Yeah. Masahide, in the case when you have a Gorsky degree of freedom, last slides. So this degree of freedom is a scalar. Is it just a kind of standard Ostrogradsky ghost?
Just this theory is not degenerate. So
associated
with the higher derivative. Yeah.
So this theory will propagate to graviton polarization and to scalars, right? Is it correct?
Generically, it's as long as I remember, one scalar goes to degree of freedom.
Ah, just scalar, just one scalar.
Yeah, associated with the second derivative of scalar.
So there are two plus one degrees of freedom still.
No, two plus two.
Okay.
Yeah.
And is it like a generic feature that you have basically 2+1 or 2+2 if you are not lucky? I mean, I'm asking naively if it's clear that there are no extra degrees of freedom connected to torsion, to excitation of torsion, let's say. Is it
In my opinion, or in my understanding, I think as long as we introduce a higher derivative, it is more natural to have a ghost degree of freedom. So in this sense, 2+2 is more natural.
Mm-hmm.
And in case of the metric formalism, metric formalism is a bit special. Galilean in metric formalism, because in flat space, we have a Galilean shift symmetry, you see. But in this case, you see, depending on the position of the G mu nu. So even if we take a flat limit, it's same. So as long as we consider the higher derivative, it's more natural to have a ghost degree of freedom. So in general, we should have a ghost.
Mm-hmm.
But point is that, sorry.
Mm-hmm. No, please
go ahead. Yeah.
No, what I was asking is, naively, it would look that because you have some non-metricity thing, so I'm asking in general, I would naively expect more degrees of freedom, you see, because it's like a tensor with string indices, you know?
So in this sense, so maybe I might confused or I don't remember exactly. It might happen 4+2. It might happen, yes.
I see. But if for example, I couple to fermions, would anything drastical happen? Like you would excite new degrees of freedom or not? Can it happen?
I think so. Yeah, originally, I'm not yet familiar with fermion in Palatine formalism, but originally, my collaborator worked on that topic more intensively. And Palatine formalism is more natural in terms of in the sense of the gauge theories. And I think, drastically changed.
Mm. Okay, thank you.
Alex?
Hi, Masahide. I'm surprised it's you who is the first. Fantastic talk. Look, I'm just a bit puzzled. So as far as I remember, the reason why additional degrees of freedom were disappearing in this braiding or g-inflation was that either it was because this term, you could basically get rid of second time derivatives by integrating by parts. And that's why it was obvious that, okay, then the action is just basically only first order in time derivatives. The other reason, which is related to the first one, was this Riemann identity. I think it's called Riemann, the commutator of two covariant derivatives, which is getting reduced. So here it does not work because these identities don't hold for non-metric connections.
I think such a non-metricity is crucial.
It's because of this this commutator is not Riemann tensor anymore, in a sense.
Not a standard Riemann tensor in metricity. I mean, not standard Riemann tensor with respect to Lebesgue beta. Because connection is also modified.
Right. And therefore this thing doesn't basically reduce the order. Okay.
No.
Very good. Thanks a lot.
Alexander?
Do you hear me?
Yes.
It was a very interesting talk, but I have probably a naive question. You said that is one let us say, formalism predicted that you have to have gravitational wave, speed of gravitational wave, which is equal to speed of light. But another formalism predicts that you could have some deviation. But question is, how to choose the suitable formalism? Because always experiment will not give you precise answer. Like, so precisely you have to have, probably in experiment always you have some deviation. So speed of gravity and speed of light. Thank you.
Yeah, this is a very good question. And yeah, in fact, in the first part of my talk, yeah, I said that from observation determines which formalism is correct, you see. But this might not be true because, for example, in this particular case, we can, or if, even if we begin with this action in paratini formalism, we can always have a completely equivalent action in metric formalism. You see? So, and this is, in the action level, this is completely equivalent. And so, of course, the prediction is completely equivalent. So, unless we know the starting action, you see, we cannot discriminate from observation. So, it depends on the starting action or, the fundamental theory. Because if we claim that begin with this action in paratini formalism, but someone claims that I begin with a dosed action in metric formalism, these are completely equivalent, you see. So even if we have an observational result, we cannot discriminate. So just in some sense, your test, if you say this is more simpler, I'm not sure, of course, this dose might be simpler. So unless we don't know the such a first principle or fundamental theory, we cannot discriminate. Because we can, even if we begin with the paratini formalism, we can always have some correspondent action in metric formalism. In this sense, in some sense, this is similar in the Jordan frame or Einstein frame in the metric formalism. Just a conformal transformation makes change the physical interpretation, and the physics itself does not change. In this sense, these two actions are completely equivalent. So no difference. I'm not sure this is a clear answer to your question or not.
It was very clear. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much, Masaide. And I think we can
thank you very much.